All right, our next presentation will be from Matthew Eisaman and Brendan Carter. Matthew is an assistant professor in the Electrical and Computer Engineering Department at Stony Brook University, and Brendan Carter is a research scientist with the University of Washington's Cooperative Institute for Climate, Ocean, and Ecosystem Studies. Let's play their video.
Thanks for the invitation to present this lightning talk. I'm Matt Eisaman from Stony Brook University, and my colleague Brendan Carter from the University of Washington and I will talk about research needs to deploy and scale the negative emissions technology known as direct ocean capture. So to start, direct air capture may be more familiar to everyone. This is a process that allows us to capture carbon dioxide directly from the air. And the idea is you need to contact that with some sorbent, whether liquid or solid, that's man-made. Because of the low concentration of CO2 in the air, you need a large surface area, a large volume of this sorbent, and then the CO2 can be regenerated thermally, chemically, or using moisture swing processes to get more concentrated CO2 at the end. The idea of direct ocean capture is to capture CO2 from the air, but to do so using the huge surface area that the ocean naturally gives us, and to use the natural ocean atmosphere equilibrium to capture CO2 into the ocean. And so in comparing it to direct air capture, direct ocean capture shown on the left uses the surface area of the ocean and the natural ocean atmosphere equilibrium to exchange CO2 with the ocean, and then uses electrochemistry to either desorb the CO2 as a gas, precipitate the CO2 in solid calcium carbonate form, or to store that CO2 as bicarbonate ions in the ocean. This picture just shows one example implementation, possible implementation of direct ocean capture. So in this case, our electrochemical system is the membrane stack shown in the upper left. And that is on some sort of floating platform. Electricity and seawater are the inputs to this membrane stack, and the outputs are hydrochloric acid to the left and sodium hydroxide, basic sodium hydroxide to the right. That sodium hydroxide is dosed in a controlled fashion into the ocean, and that results in CO2 drawdown from the air into the ocean, where the CO2 is stored as bicarbonate ions. Some key points of this process are that it's safe for marine life because you can keep the maximum temporary pH change to less than or equal to 0.4 units. And importantly, the CO2 stored in this form is stable as bicarbonate for 10,000 to 200,000 years. In addition, even if you don't exceed pre-industrial pH levels, this has the potential to sequester 85 petagrams of CO2 a year, that is 85 gigatons of CO2 a year, more than two times current human emissions. So in order to implement these kinds of direct ocean capture processes, I'll turn it over to Brendan to talk about some of the research needs.
Thank you, Matt. So there are two broad spheres of research that would need to be conducted before this technology is implemented in the real ocean in a major way. The first has to deal with the very pragmatic question of how can we do this most cost effectively, and how can we implement this in the ocean, which is notoriously corrosive, remote, exposed to the elements, and prone to biofouling. The second set of questions has to deal with how do we implement this in a way that's not going to make a mess out of modern marine ecosystems? Sub-questions for this are, once we add a strong base, how quickly is it diluted by ocean mixing and currents? Once it's diluted a bit, how long does it take before the air-sea gas exchange brings the pH back down to a level that we would kind of consider normal? And finally, how much strong base can we add before we start negatively impacting marine life? For the example that Matt discussed earlier, we're circumventing that question by just making sure that we never bring pH outside of the pre-industrial bounds. The second sphere of questions can be very effectively addressed using ocean circulation models that were developed for simulating marine ecosystems and climate change impacts. We can now also use these models to simulate how plumes of base additions disperse, and also what the timescales of the consequent air-sea CO2 exchanges are. We can also compare how the chemical impacts differ when the bases are added to different regions within the model. The simulation shown here is just an example of ocean circulation model output from a model that's designed for the Bering Sea. Okay, thank you for your time, and we wanted to conclude leaving this final slide up here, which is just an example timeline showing some of the research that might need to be done over the next half decade or so.
Thank you to Matt and Brendan for sharing their thoughts on this really exciting new avenue for addressing carbon.